CNN's Boris Sanchez live now at the White House for us. Boris, that's a senior senator saying it's a very real question whether or not President Trump is knowingly working to help the Russians. How's that and other reactions hitting the White House, a very snowy White House right now?
Yeah, Anna, no reaction yet specifically to what lawmakers have said about these two stories. You heard President Trump's response on Fox News to reporting in the New York Times and the Washington Post, both bombshell reports dropping on the White House this weekend. The president did tweet a little bit about the New York Times report, not really addressing any of the specific accusations or the details of that report, really just blasting James Comey and peddling deep state conspiracies about Robert Mueller. Press Secretary Sarah Sanders put out two statements about both of these reports. They're very, very similar. Not only does she dismiss these reports, but she suggests in both of them with very similar language that President Trump has been tougher on Russia than President Obama was. Anna, you know this well. We've all seen the photograph of President Trump publicly pressing Vladimir Putin on the issue of Russian election meddling, something that President Trump has never done. Further, we don't know if President Trump has done it privately either, and that's the gist of this Washington Post report, saying that U.S. officials don't know the content of conversations between President Trump and the Russian president. President Trump has been active on Twitter today. He's tweeted about the American presence of troops overseas. He's also tweeted about the snowy White House and, of course, the government shutdown. As we're now entering the fourth week of the shutdown, the president at one point tweeted, quote, "I'm in the White House waiting. The Democrats are everywhere, but Washington, as people await their pay, they are having fun and not even talking." We should point out many Republicans also left Washington for their home districts this weekend. But it is clear at this point, neither side is actually talking, moving forward with discussions on how to reopen the federal government, Anna.
Boris, something that's just into CNN as well is looking at how things are being run around the Oval Office and one particular interaction between the president and his new acting chief of staff. What are you hearing?
Yeah, this is a bit of an eyebrow-raising statement the president apparently made to his new acting chief of staff, Mick Mulvaney. According to a source I just spoke with a few moments ago, they tell me that during a Situation Room meeting with congressional leadership, including Democrats and Republicans, toward the end of that meeting, Mick Mulvaney started talking about the offer that Democrats had made to reopen the federal government, that $1.3 billion figure that there was an agreement to between Republicans and Democrats until the president changed his mind. And the president, mid-sentence, cut off Mulvaney saying, quote, "Stop, stop, just stop. What are you doing? You're effing it all up, Mick." That's according to an official who was in the room for the negotiations. And according to the source, there was shockingly no reaction at all from anyone in the room. According to my source, several Democrats had also been ribbing at Mulvaney during these negotiations. So clearly a very difficult jumping off point for the new acting chief of staff to not only get it from the president, but also from Democrats, Anna.
Boris Sanchez in a very stormy Washington tonight. Thank you. With us now, thanks, CNN presidential historians Douglas Brinkley and Tim Naftali. Doug, there's this quote from the Washington Post. "No detailed record, even in classified files, of Trump's face-to-face interactions with the Russian leader at five locations over the past 2 years." Just how unprecedented is that?
Well, certainly since the end of World War II, it's unprecedented. FDR met with Stalin, Joseph Stalin, at Yalta, and there weren't great notes kept on that, and it created a lot of confusion in the early Cold War years because nobody knows what was said. But since that point of time, we've always had other people in the room, and FDR had people in the room to say what they thought occurred. Now we're in this place, you know, it's absolutely stunning that Donald Trump made a fool of himself in Helsinki, that we know that he's under investigation for collusion with Russia. Now he has five meetings with Putin, and he's trying to silence the translator, destroy notes of what may or may not have been said. So this is a president that's creating a global image of himself, if not an agent of Russia, of some kind of patsy or somebody that's being blackmailed by the Kremlin. And it's an unfortunate and embarrassing situation we have going right now, and deeply dangerous and disturbing, this Putin-Trump relationship, to my mind.
Tim, Trump allies say the president likes these intimate meetings to try to establish a rapport, and he was also worried about leaks, perhaps explaining why he didn't want the interaction to get out there, why he confiscated the notes, which we know leaks were a problem at the beginning of this administration. Is that a fair point?
Since the middle of 2016, when then-candidate Donald Trump seemed to encourage the Russians to access Hillary Clinton's emails, the missing emails, he's had a credibility problem among people who study security matters and people who are responsible for U.S. counterespionage and counterintelligence. You would think that someone who understood this credibility problem would take special care not to give people reason to doubt these interactions with Putin. What is so striking about this information, the reporting of the Washington Post, is that it seems that not only is Donald Trump not concerned that his government be fully informed on what he's saying to Putin, he's actively attempting to prevent his closest associates from knowing what he's saying to Putin privately. There have been some meetings, private meetings between presidents and Soviet leaders. Richard Nixon, for example, had a 15-minute meeting alone with Brezhnev and Brezhnev's interpreter. He, by the way, taped it. But no one at that point was thinking that Richard Nixon was going to give the store away to Moscow. But Donald Trump is in a different situation. There are many legitimate questions about Donald Trump's interest when he talks to the Russians. And for him, in that environment, to be so secretive is worrying, troubling, and a little suspicious.
Now, the president and the White House have continued to sort of brush this off and try to hammer home this message.
If you ask the folks in Russia, I've been tougher on Russia than anybody else, probably any other president, period. But certainly the last three or four presidents, modern day presidents, nobody's been as tough as I have from any standpoint.
Doug, is that accurate? Put that into context for us.
No, it's wildly inaccurate. He's the best friend that Russia's had. And I'm talking about even, you know, for decades. Look at what's happened in the last couple of years since Trump's been president. It's a gift to Putin. The United States now pulling out of Syria, the undermining of our NATO alliance, the pulling out of the climate accord, and making Russia look good on the issue of climate, and the United States not in the game at all. The Trans-Pacific trade deal, which Putin didn't want to see go through, blown up by Donald Trump. Trump seems to have an agenda right in line with Putin, and it perplexes people. It's why we constantly think there's something amiss here, that, you know, there's too much Russia going on and not enough Americanism. And so I'm deeply concerned that these stories that have just come out are only adding to this narrative that Donald Trump seems to be beholden to Putin. We don't know whether it's because of financial dealings in the 1980s or about collusion in the 2016 election, or whether there's some secret tape they have. But you get the feeling that Trump is being blackmailed by Russia, and that has to be a deep concern to anybody that cares about this, the future of our country and national security.